You received your bulletin, and if you open it, in the right hand, under the title January, Join Us, I want to highlight those titles. The first of them is from January the 1st to the 11th, we got the 10 days of prayer. That means that we are using the middle. 10 days of prayer, 6 a.m. and 6 p.m. And I'm going to use fast. January 11. You know that in the rest of the countries, except the United States, we say first the day, then the month, then the year. Here is backwards, but I used to now. January 11, Bible study in English and in Spanish, 6:30 p.m. That is starting the coming Wednesday. For the Hispanic people, desde el próximo miércoles comenzamos los estudios bíblicos en español de 6 y 30, todos los miércoles a las 6:30. Now you can invite all the people you meet on the streets that you see like they speak Spanish. Hey, you speak Spanish? Yes, oh, come on. And you show you the bulletin. See, we have Spanish courses just Wednesday, every Wednesday, 6:30. Now you can invite them, please. Remember that. Monthly prayer meeting, 6:30 p.m., January the 20th. Monthly prayer meeting. More specifics in the coming days. January the 21st, fellowship meal after service. Oh, some of you are smiling. Meal. I always, when I hear these announcements, always in my mind is the soup from the Philippines brothers, oh man. Bombabil soup, I love it. And then January the 28th, Adventures Bible Game. That's in the conference. The Adventures are gonna participate from Panama City, Seventh-day Adventists, and the conference, and the conference level. And they are very excited about it. And you see, you turn the last page of the bulletin, it says Pastor Challenge. We don't want to read it now, but please take it with you in the afternoon, after the nap, not before the nap. You are going to check it out, read it, and then you are going to know about what is the challenge for us, for everyone. And if you have any question, just please don't hesitate to call the pastor. There's the phone number. Just be sure that you can clear all the questions you have. Once more, thank you for coming today, for choosing between another full things or appointments or things that you have to do today. You choose to come to Panama City Seventh-day Adventist Church. Welcome back.
Good morning for an happy Sabbath. Let's all stand for our opening prayer. Let's pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts, the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Sabbath to everyone. For God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not have perished, but have everlasting life. We are here to share the amazing love with you today. So just open your hearts to us and sing in your hearts.
Forgiven. Because you are forsaken, I'm accepted. You are condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again.
Stand for the opening hymn. The opening hymn is number 590, Trust and Obey. 590, Trust and Obey.
Trust and obey. Trust.
Happy Sabbath. I guess this is our first Sabbath of the new year, so we can still talk about New Year's resolutions, right? Yeah. All right, well, it is a new year. Let's make a resolution this year as a church. You know, let's, as we're talking about offerings, let's give to Jesus, right? But there's several ways to give to Jesus. I think financially is important, right? That's what we're doing. We're doing offering. But there is a lot more that we can do besides financially, right? I think there's several ways to give to Jesus this year. I think there is giving of your time, okay? I think that's very important. It's arguably our most precious thing that we have to give is time. And I think our church is growing. I think, you know, things are happening. And I think we need more of the time that you guys have to give for us in this church this year. There's ways to help, right? You can give your time helping others in need outside the church. You can give your time helping of those in need in the church, right? Many of you have lots of different gifts. You've got the gift of teaching. You've got the gift of friendship. You've got the gift of praying. You've got the gift of hospitality. And I know several of you have the gift of cooking, right? So let's combine all those gifts this year, okay? Let's make a resolution as a church to give of ourselves, give of our time, give of our gifts, okay? So may the deacons come forward. All right, if you all can bow your heads for me. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for a new year. We thank you for the opportunity to kind of reset this year, refocus, Lord. Help us to, as a church, make a united resolution to give more of ourselves to you, to each other, and to this church so that we can grow and continue to do your message and your plan for our church, Lord. In your name we pray, amen.
Hello, church. We are blessed today to share with you the 10 days of prayer, the seventh day, both in Esther and Daniel. So we ask you to grab your pew Bible or your Bible with you to first turn to Esther chapter 7.
So the king and Haman went to dine with Queen Esther. And on the second day, at the banquet of wine, the king again said to Esther, "What is your petition, Queen Esther? It shall be granted you. And what is your request? Up to half the kingdom, it shall be done." Then Queen Esther answered and said, "If I have found favor in your sight, O king, and if it pleases the king, let my life be given me at my petition, and my people at my request. For we have been sold, my people and I, to be destroyed, to be killed, and to be annihilated. Had we been sold as male and female slaves, I would have held my tongue, although the enemy could never compensate for the king's loss." So King Ahasuerus answered and said to Queen Esther, "Who is he and where is he who would dare presume in his heart to do such a thing?" And Esther said, "The adversary and enemy is this wicked Haman." So Haman was terrified before the king and queen. Then the king arose in his wrath from the banquet of wine and went into the palace garden. But Haman stood before Queen Esther pleading for his life, for he saw that evil was determined against him by the king. When the king returned from the palace garden to the place of the banquet of wine, Haman had fallen across the couch where Esther was. Then the king said, "Will he also assault the queen while I am in the house?" As the word left the king's mouth, they covered Haman's face. Now Harbona, one of the eunuchs, said to the king, "Look, the gallows 50 cubits high, which Haman made for Mordecai, who had spoke good on the king's behalf, is standing at the house of Haman." Then the king said, "Hang him on it." So they hanged Haman on the gallows that he had prepared for Mordecai. Then the king's wrath subsided. This is the word of the Lord.
I'll give you a moment to turn to Daniel chapter 7. This one's a bit longer. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head while on his bed. Then he wrote down the dream, telling the main facts. Daniel spoke, saying, "I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea. And four great beasts came from the sea, and each different from the other. First was like a lion, and his eagles and had eagle's wings. I watched till its wings were plucked off, and it was lifted up from the earth and made to stand on 2 feet like a man, and a man's heart was given to it. And suddenly another beast, a second, like a bear. It was raised up on one side and had 3 ribs in its mouth between its teeth. And they said thus to it, 'Arise, devour much flesh.' After this I looked, and there was another, like a leopard, which had on its back 4 wings of a bird. The beast also had 4 heads, and dominion was given to it. After this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a 4th beast, dreadful and terrible, exceedingly strong. It had huge iron teeth. It was devouring, breaking in pieces, and trampling the residue with its feet. It was different from all the other beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. I had considered the horns, and there was another horn, a little horn, coming up from among them, before whom 3 of the 1st horns were plucked out by the roots. And there in this horn were eyes like a man, and a mouth speaking pompous words. I watched till thrones were in place, and the Ancient of Days was seated. His garment was white with snow, and his hair of his head was like pure wool. His throne was a fiery flame, its wheels a burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. 1,000 thousands ministered to him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated and the books were opened. I watched, then because of the sound of the pompous words which the horn was speaking, I watched till the beast was slain and his body destroyed and given to the burning flame. As for the rest of the beasts, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. I was watching in the night vision, and behold, one like the Son of Man, coming with clouds of heaven. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Then to him was given dominion and glory and kingdom. Then all peoples, nations, languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom the one which shall not be destroyed. I, Daniel, was grieved in my spirit within my body, and the visions of my head had troubled me. I came to one of those who stood by and asked him the truth of all this. So he told me and made known to me the interpretation of these things. Those great beasts, which are four kings, which arise out of the earth, but the saints of the Most High shall receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever and forever and ever. Then I wished to know the truth about the fourth beast, which was different from all the others, exceedingly dreadful, with its teeth of iron and its nails of bronze, which devoured, broke in pieces, and trampled the residue with its feet. And the ten horns that were its head, and the other horn which came up before, which three fell, naming that horn which had eyes and a mouth which spoke pompous words, which appearance was greater than his fellows. I was watching, and the same horn was making war against the saints and prevailing against them until the Ancient of Days came, and a judgment was made in favor of the saints of the Most High, and the time came for the saints to possess the kingdom. Thus he said, the four beasts shall be a fourth kingdom on the earth, which shall be different from all other kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, trample it, and break it in pieces. The ten horns are ten kings who shall arise from the kingdom, and another shall rise after them. He shall be different from the first ones, and shall subdue three kings. He shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and shall intend to change times and law. Then the saints shall be given into his hand for a time and times and half a time. But the court shall be seated, and they shall take away his dominion to consume and destroy it forever. Then the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdoms under the whole heaven shall be given to the people, the saints of the Most High. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey. This is the end of the account. As for me, Daniel, my thoughts greatly troubled me, and my countenance changed, but I kept the matter in my heart.
It is time for family prayer. We want to respect this time as we take prayer seriously. For the prayer, we have a little song that we will sing. So just tune your hearts and mind heavenwards for the out of birth.
Good morning, Panama City Saints, as the pastor would say. I've been tasked with giving our altar of prayer. It's been a long time since I've been in this position. The Lord has blessed me tremendously. I wanted to talk a little bit about the 10 days of prayer before I did the altar of prayer. It's been a true blessing to attend the first 6 days of the altar of prayer that's going on in our church. We've assessed our spiritual life. We've learned what it means to consecrate and to commemorate our lives. We learned what it means to love God. We've also learned how to pray, when to pray, and how to end our day. What a blessing it is to have the pastor pray for each of our individual requests, and know that our fellow believers are praying for them also. Brothers and sisters, what I want to do this morning is lift up the various requests that have been offered on our prayer line at 6 o'clock in the morning. I know that seems kind of early, but God is always up.
Amen.
Listening to our requests. He never sleeps and he never slumbers.
Yes, amen.
And so when we're up, he's always there, has an ear listening to us. So when we talk to God, all we have to do is just open our hearts and open our minds to hear him speak to us. Many times we are wondering if it's very easy for us to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning to spend time with him. But remember, he was always there on the cross for us to bear that burden for us. So what we're going to do is talk about our prayer requests, but I'm going to talk about them in categories as I pray. And as we bow our heads or kneel as far as possible, we want to have a prayer of in our hearts as we listen to them.
Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace. Send us love, send us
Father in heaven, we thank you for this privilege of prayer. We thank you that you made that connection back to you. We're praying this morning, Lord, for healing of hearts. Many hearts are broken. Many hearts are hurting. We come here, Lord, we don't know what's dealing with anyone that's here. They may come here lonely. They may come here broken and sad. But you know as soon as they came through the door. We're praying for healing of the spirit. Broken spirit, Lord. The spirit that is downtrodden, feeling like that there is no hope. But they're hanging on because they know that there's something better, and that's why they're here. Help us, Lord, as a church, to reach out to them. And Lord, there is a number of people that have asked for prayer requests for healing of health. I know that our health is very important, Lord, but you can still work with us even though we're wounded and we're not working very well. But we pray, Lord, that you would give us healing because you promised in your word that you would grant us our request. Lord, many people are requesting that their children be returned back to you. You said, Lord, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he won't depart. And we claim that promise, Lord, that you will bring our children back to the fold. Family wants to be reconciled together, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you will bring families together. Bring the love that you have to that family so that they can feel that love toward one another, so that they can feel that unity together within their families. Lord, there's many people that are in the valley of decision. They're not totally sure which way to turn because the devil is busy. He's trying to make the world look like it's a better place to be than to be with you. But Lord, we pray that as they are in that valley of decision, that they will recognize that the home that they have, that you have prepared for them, are far outweighs what this earthly world can provide. And Lord, we want to spend quality time with you. We want to be able to rise up early in the morning, but the devil makes that bed feel so wonderful. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to be able to rise up early, early in the morning so that we can spend that quality time with you, so that we can develop that closer walk with you in the early times when there's no distractions, so that we can learn to listen to your voice and hear your voice and know when you're speaking to us, and that we can draw closer to you, and that we can become more unified as a church. Because if we are closer to you, we can become closer to each other, because we have a mission. Our mission is to bring people to you so that your soon coming will be drawn nearer. We want to spread the gospel to hasten your soon coming. So help us to be a unified church and without division. We're praying for our pastor and his family as he leads the flock. I pray, Lord, that you would lift him up on your wings and continue to bless him with this mission. Thank you for the privilege of prayer. And all these things I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, Panama City Saints. Can we get an amen?
Amen.
Can we get a hallelujah?
Hallelujah?
Can we get a glory be to God? Do you truly believe that God is faithful? Can we get an amen?
Amen?
The Lord is doing so many things in our midst. I can tell you that these were just a few of the things that the Lord did in the Panama City Seventh-day Adventist Church in 2022. And we are just grateful for the great things that He has done, but also excited for the great things that He will do in 2023. Amen? If this is your first time here, I just want to take a moment to say thank you and welcome. We are just really appreciative that you have decided to be in the house of the Lord. If this is maybe your first or second time, would you raise your hand for just a moment? Would you raise your hand? I have a couple here in the back. God bless you. You're ours. Who else? We have a couple in the back as well. God bless you. I had an opportunity to meet you back in the Hispanic Sabbath School class. We do have another individual here present. We are very excited that you have decided to join us. And also everyone watching online, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us all delight in it. And we are just grateful for the opportunity. So Panama City Saints, let's just acknowledge the presence of all of our friends and visitors and guests. May the Lord be with you and may you be blessed this Sabbath morning. If you are a Facebook user, go on like Panama City SDA and just follow us and share the live stream broadcast. Also, with that in mind, let me share with you, just like you see a couple of minutes before, thank you, Adam and Sam, and also Sister Anita for leading us in our 10 days of prayer. We will continue tomorrow at 6 a.m., this afternoon, 6 p.m., individually, every morning from here to Wednesday. We will end up Wednesday. It's going to be a total of 11 days, but that's okay. So we're going to do 6 a.m. via Facebook, and 6 p.m., you have the responsibility to pray on your own, no matter where you are. So please join us for that. We are going to be fasting this coming Wednesday. We fasted last Wednesday, and we will continue to fast to close out the 10 days of prayer. We go back to our norm in terms of our Bible studies. We're going to have Bible studies in addition to the ones that we had before. Now we go back to having the Spanish Bible studies in this room and then the English Bible studies at 6:30. Please come and join us. It's going to be a great blessing for your life, and we will continue our journey. Prayer meeting, monthly prayer meeting, January the 20th at 6 p.m. You are more than welcome to join us in that regard as well. And on the 21st, we have our fellowship meal. Bring a delicious dish. It's going to be a high Sabbath. You need to be a part of that. We close out the month with our Adventurer Bible game at the Gulf States Conference. So please pay attention to that. Now, let me just share with you briefly. In the pews in front of you, you may have a card just like this. This is primarily for parents. A couple of guidelines that we decided to share with you in regards to how to approach your children in the sanctuary. We want to be a children's friendly church and at the same time keep the reverence that is necessary. So this is a great way for you to go about dealing with your children at church. So we encourage you to take a look. And last but not least, please take a look at this that I have in my hands. It is a calendar for 2023. And here we have the new slogan for the year. It is, can you read what it says there? Just shout it out. God is what? God is mighty. I will encourage our deacons to come forward if you would like to receive one of these. We only have so many, so one per family. Just raise your hand if you'd like to receive one of these and take it home. Mark it down, those special dates of prayer, those special days that you are going to fast, those special days that you are going to come before the Lord. This is for the sake of having a reminder at home for you to use this for church related activities. So we will encourage you to take it and probably paste it on your fridge or something like that. And please take advantage of that great blessing. With that in mind, I just want to say that we count on your prayers. We count on your support to continue to do the ministry that the Lord has called us to do in Panama City. So let us all continue to do the work that God has called us, and may we all enjoy our worship service. The calendar is entitled God is Mighty, and we start that with the 10 days of prayer. Now, as we close out this moment, we are going to repeat at the count of three. We connect, we equip, and we grow. Are you guys ready?
Yes.
Okay, let's do it. One, two, and three. We connect, we equip, and we grow. Let's move forward in worship. God bless you.
Please pray that this message goes out and it glorifies God and not me. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, true faith in you. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there's despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. O Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving to all men that we receive, and in dying that we're born to eternal life. O Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there's despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath, church. We'll turn our Bibles to Daniel 2, verse 17 and 18. And it's read, then Daniel went to his house and made the decision known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companion, 18 and last, that they might seek mercy from the God of heaven concerning the secret, so that Daniel and his companion might not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Here endeth a portion of God's holy words.
All right. We have reached that section of our service where it's time to hear the word of the Lord. But just as how when you're going to cook the chicken, you don't just put it in the pot like that. You have to prepare it first. So we are here today to prepare your hearts and your mind for the blessed sermon.
Come to our only
defenses be brought down so that your message may fall into good grounds in our hearts. I pray that you would speak to us this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. You may be seated. Many years ago, a plaque dating back to the 11th century was found in the middle of an archaeological expedition. In the plaque, there was an inscription that narrated a traditional Jewish story of two cities that were divided in half by a river. The story is super interesting because although it may not be completely true, we know that there's some truth to it. While one of the cities was prosperous and enjoyed an abundance of fruits, vegetations, and cattle, the other was struggling with poverty and malnutrition. So think about that. The same weather, the same location, the same type of ground, right? The same type of situation, the same area, and yet one of the cities was struggling while the other was thriving. So a committee was formed to try to determine what the situation was. The wise men in town were gathered, and they said, "We need you guys to determine the reason why we are struggling while the other city who is here with us sharing this land is thriving. There's got to be something. We have thought about everything, and yet the truth is that we are poor, that we do not have the resources. It seems that we don't have a blessing and favor in our midst." So the committee was formed, and they started to think about every single detail that made this particular city different from the other across the river. Long story short, after so much consideration, they concluded that there was one difference and one difference only between the two cities. How many differences? One difference. And it was that the prosperous city had the bones of the prophet Daniel in their possession. Right? So the king, the one who reigned over both cities with the river in the middle, came up with the brilliant idea of just building a bridge across both towns, right? And there in a box, they hang the bones of the prophet Daniel. And in the inauguration ceremony, in his discourse, in his speech, he pronounced the following words. Daniel is for everyone. Are you guys with me? Amen. Daniel is for who? For everyone. Just like I said before. It may be just a fable or a story that is not completely true, yet the words from the mouth of the king are completely true. The book of Daniel is for everyone. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter where you come from. It doesn't matter what you have gone through. There's a message of encouragement of a sovereign God that sits on the throne awaiting for you in the pages of the book of Daniel. Can I get an amen? There are many lessons to be learned from the book of Daniel, and these are applicable to every single follower of Jesus. And like pearls found in oysters, there's so much hidden value to be exploited when looking at the overarching themes of this wonderful book. So this morning, in accordance to the reading of our 10 days of prayer, we will take some lessons assigned or some lessons taken from the book of Daniel in accordance to our 10 days of prayer. We will go over some of the spiritual lessons that God has left for us in this particular book. Now, one of the first lessons to keep in mind while reading the book of Daniel is that prophecy is also related to prayer. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Prophecy is also related to prayer. You cannot detach prayer from prophecy, and you cannot detach prophecy from prayer. They go together, and we learn this while we read the book of Daniel. Prophecy is also related to prayer. In fact, Daniel is a book about prayer. Although you may not realize at first glance, the book of Daniel highlights the centrality of prayer as a key component in the life of the believer. Daniel shows us that prayer is connected to history. Prayer is not some sort of mystic endeavor that you as a Christian get into that is not within the mundane of your life and detached from your current circumstances. That is not what prayer is all about. Prayer is connected with history. Prayer is for the here and the now. And although it has eternal consequences, it is for us to take advantage of it right now as we speak, as we go through the hills and valleys of the biblical landscape of life. Prayer is there for us. So prophecy is also related to prayer. Note that for Daniel, more often than not, prayer was a matter of life and death. So not only as a spiritual discipline, as he used to pray how many times a day? Three times a day, but also as the key to address matters of eternal importance, just like I said before. So Daniel's prophetic gift was predicated upon his prayer life and the type of relationship that he had with the Lord. It is not one, not two, not three instances in which Daniel is faced with a very important challenge, right? And what does he say? Allow me some time so that I can go and what? Go and pray. Are you guys with me? That is why we see Daniel praying in order to understand the future. Daniel prays in order for the enigmas and the secrets of national importance to be revealed to him. So for Daniel, prophecy was rooted in prayer. Daniel understood the value of prayer as the key for knowledge and understanding. So there are at least seven prayers registered or alluded to in the book of Daniel, and each one of them shows that his spirituality and close relationship with God was predicated upon prayer. So pay attention to the following chart. The seven prayers registered in the book of Daniel. First of all, you have Daniel chapter 2, verses 17 and 19. Here we have the petition that he posts to his friends, right? We have this situation. We are going to be killed. The king has requested for us to interpret this dream. Let's go back and pray. This was our scripture reading, right? So Daniel understand that for him to be successful in the mundane of life, he had to pray. So he goes and prays in Daniel chapter 2. And right after that, we have this thanksgiving prayer, because Daniel knows that along with that prayer, he's seeking after power, he's seeking after knowledge, he's seeking after wisdom. And the more he prays, the more grounded he will be and the better off he'll be in order to obtain the goal that he has in front of him. So Daniel goes and pray, and we have at least two prayers registered in the second chapter of the book of Daniel. Then we have an implied prayer in Daniel chapter 3. When the Hebrew boys are called to bow down into the statue, for many Bible scholars, Daniel was not even there. But we know from some Seventh-day Adventist scholars over the last couple of years that this may not be the case. Daniel might be there as well, and I have an explanation for that, but that's a topic for some other time. My point here is that the idea of worshiping in the plain of Dura is also connected to the idea of prayer, of worship, and adoration in itself. So we need to understand that if Daniel was there present while these instruments were blowing, he must have been praying as well. It is not only in chapters 2 and 3. We also have an allusion to prayer in Daniel chapter 6, right? And this is the whole reason why he's taken to the lion's den, right? In chapter 6, he goes back and he prays his prayer of thanksgiving just like he did every single day, despite of the consequences. He was so focused. He was so rooted in prayer that he understood that no matter what, prayer was supposed to come first. So he prays, and we know the story. We read this yesterday. But then you have a long chapter in which Daniel goes all in as far as prayer. That is Daniel chapter 9, verses 3 to 16. He confesses for the sin of his people. And then in Daniel 9, 17 through 19, he intercedes on behalf of the city and the people. He says, Lord, do not delay, right? So he's saying these things. Let me ask you one quick question. Was Daniel at fault and he committed a sin at this particular moment? Yes or no? He did not. So we have this principle here of corporate solidarity in which you as the first and the parent of the household, the patriarch, right? Whatever happened in your home was also predicated and it touched you in the same way. So even though he did not sin, he is coming with the same kind of confession and the same mindset of saying, I am a part of this. He confesses and then he intercedes. That is why all the more we need a praying church in Panama City. Because when someone pains, we all pain. When someone celebrates, we all celebrate. When there's hurting, we all hurt. This idea of being together is also established in Daniel chapter 9 with these two particular prayers. And how about Daniel chapter 10? We have this idea of consecration and persistent over and over and over. And the angelic conflict is explained in Daniel chapter 10 and going to chapters 11 and 12. And we have this idea that the angel touched him. Glory be to God. Do you think that an angel will touch someone that has not devoted himself to prayer? Absolutely not. So these seven prayers taken from the book of Daniel show us that prophecy is also related to prayer. And prayer is huge for the life of whatever Christian. So we understand that Daniel was a man of prayer. For him, it was a matter of life and death. And the book conveys this idea of spiritual discipline through prayer. At its core, it is prayer that gives sense to your Christian walk. For some Christian, trying to do life without prayer would be the same one or the same thing as trying to live your life without breathing. Because prayer is the air for our spiritual lungs. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
That is what prayer is. I have found so many Christians, especially now in the new year, with new goals. Pastor, I want to deepen my relationship with God. Pastor, I want to get closer to Jesus. Pastor, I want to be back to where I was 10 or 12 years from now. Oh, Panama City Saints, it doesn't matter where you are. It all starts with prayer. Amen. It is through prayer. It is with prayer. And this is a great idea, a great concept in Romans chapter 7 and verse 19 and 20. The more spiritual the activity, the more pushback you will receive from within. Paul says, the sin that dwells within me keeps me away from doing what I want. Let me tell you this, Panama City Saints. That's the reason why for so many of us, it is way easier to study the Bible than praying. Are you guys with me? The more spiritual the activity, the more pushback you'll receive from within. If you were to decide to go back to the gym and get back in shape, all you need is your discipline, time, the ability to do so. You can master it, right? There's no spirituality into that. You're dealing with yourself. But when you say, I want to get back and get closer to Jesus, get what's happened. You need the discipline. You need all of that. But on top of that, there's a spiritual warfare happening and going on within you. Because the more spiritual the activity, the more pushback you will receive. Are you guys with me? That is why we cannot waver or wait into prayer. Let's pray more. In season and out of season, in the book of Daniel, we find a prayer of petition, thanksgiving, adoration, thanksgiving again, confession, intercession, consecration. These are great prayers for us to go back and do in our time, in our quiet time with Jesus. So as far as the structure of the book, let me tell you this. We need to realize that Daniel chapter 1 serves as an outline or a summary of the whole book. Everybody say outline. Daniel chapter 1 is an outline of the book in itself. If you can pay attention here, we have the three main characters of the book, right? You have King Nebuchadnezzar in Daniel 1:1 is introduced, right? Then we have Daniel introduced for the first time in verse 6. And then Cyrus is briefly mentioned in verse 21, the very last verse of the chapter. And these are the same individuals who are brought up later in the book. You have King Nebuchadnezzar who takes the primary focus of attention in chapters 2. Right? With the statue that is provided. Then Nebuchadnezzar is also the main figure in the plain of Dura, chapter 3. Chapter 4, when he acts like an animal, right? Chapter 4, you have Nebuchadnezzar, the first half of the book. But then you have Daniel taking over in chapter 5, right? When he reads the writing on the wall, Mene, Mene, Teke, Parsim, right? So Daniel at this point goes into the priority of the book. And you have the same thing with Daniel chapter 7, 8, and also chapter 9 with his great prayer. And then in chapter 10, then you have Cyrus, right, being mentioned and introduced. This is the same kind of outline and flow that chapter 1 provides. So for many Seventh-day Adventist scholars, the book of Daniel is outlined in itself through the lens of Daniel chapter 1. We can expand on that in just a little bit later. With that in mind, we also have the overarching themes of the book presented in the same chapter 1. So please pay attention to me briefly. You have this idea of worship in chapter 1. Yes or no?
Yes.
For the Jewish mind, worship was related to food and through the things that you put into your body and how you eat and how you conducted yourself. You have this idea in verse 7 of chapter 1 of identity, who we are. Our names are changed, right? For the sake of making us forget who we really are, right? You have this idea of identity, and it happens also in chapter 3 with the Hebrew boys, right? So we have these overarching themes that are present in Daniel chapter 1, and they flow in the rest of the book. This idea of obedience in chapter 1 verse 8. The idea of judgment, right? Daniel says, test us, right? And this particular test, right, is this allusion to judgment that is also provided in the rest of the book. You also have God's sovereignty. And I say just glory be to God, because God continues to be seated on the throne. Amen?
Amen.
And listen to this. For 10 days, the Hebrew boys decided not to participate or partake of the food of the king's table. For how long? 10 days was the minimal measure back in those days. So try us for 10 days. And after the 10 days, Haspenas, is how you say in English? Haspenas, the eunuch, Haspenas, right? He comes and he checks them, right? And they are found how many times wiser? 10 times. So you have this correlation between the effort that is put in 10 days and also the reward that is given 10 times wiser. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Pastor, are you preaching about a works-based salvation here or the... No. Because in verse 17 of chapter 1, you have this great line that says, and God gave. God what?
Amen.
Who gave?
God.
It was God. Amen. They put in the work. They remained faithful. They were strong in their position and they remained faithful to the calling of their lives. Yet, it was God who gave. Amen. So Panama City Saints, let us all be available. Let's avail ourselves so that God may give us to us too. Can I get a witness? Amen. Throughout the Bible, throughout the book of Daniel, you have this idea. And God gave favor and grace to Daniel. Do you see that? God gave because he's the sovereign one. He is the one in control. And the faithfulness of the Hebrew boys is rewarded, right? And they are set in positions of leadership and authority. The same faithfulness that is important for you and I as end time believers to have in such a time as this, right? The day is coming in which it has come already, in which we will have to remain faithful no matter what. But we know that because of his sovereignty, he will reward us by giving us the opportunity to be with him in heaven. Amen? Amen. How is it that chapter 1 summarizes in simple terms the overarching theme of the book of Daniel? Is the word right there. Can you repeat after me? 1, 2, and 3. Say it with me. Shout it out. Holiness. Holiness. You worship, you keep your identity, you're obedient to the things that you've learned because you know that judgment is present. But in the midst of judgment, we can trust that God remains sovereign and seated on the throne, and that faithfulness will be rewarded. And that separation is what we call holiness. Got you guys with me? Yes. Now, let me walk you through my second lesson that I want you to pay attention to. The second lesson that we found in the book of Daniel is holiness is the result of and the mover to a relationship. Are you guys with me? So we have this idea that holiness is first the result and then holiness is also a trigger, right? Let me show you what I mean more detailed right now, okay? Let me show you what I mean. With this in mind, let me tell you that I see Christians so concerned about their separation from the world. Are you guys with me? No, you're not with me. Are you guys with me? I see Christians, faithful Christians, so concerned with their separation from the world, which is a good thing. Would you agree with that? Yes. It is a good thing. But they go to the extent to separate themselves from those in the world. Are you guys with me? We want to be holy. We want to be separated. We want to be kept for a divine purpose. We want to be used by God. We want to grow and we want to reach a certain level of spirituality. But for the sake of that holiness, I detach myself from other individuals. Are you guys with me? This principle right there is telling us that holiness is the result of a relationship. First and foremost, the vertical aspect. A relationship with whom? With God, right? But that relationship with God, it was causes in me, what triggers in me this need and this idea to be in a relationship with others. Because how in the world are you going to fulfill the commission of Matthew 28 if you are completely detached and separated from those around you for the sake of you being holy? It is through your holiness that you are holy because of God. And as a result of that, you go out into the world in the mundane of life, just like Daniel did, involved in the ministry and in the decisions of his nation for the sake of showing them how is it that holy people do what they do. So holiness is the result of your relationship with God, but it's also the trigger for you to be in relationship with others. So Panama City Saints, this idea is also portrayed in the structure of the book itself. You have two main sections in the book of Daniel. You have the narrative section, and that is chapters 1 through 7. Are you guys with me?
Yes.
Some people call this section the wisdom section, right? And then you have the second section that is the prophetic section of the book, chapters 7 through 12. You have a little bit of an overlap in chapter 7, right? On the one hand, you see some people that say, oh no, I'm only concerned about the moral and ethical aspect of the Bible. And they are just all the way concerned about only the narrative section to the extent that they disregard the prophetic section of the book of Daniel. I also see some individuals so concerned about the prophetic section of Scripture and specifically the book of Daniel that they disregard the narrative and historical value of the book in itself. So just like I said before that holiness goes hand in hand, I want you to understand that the moral aspect and the ethical aspect of the book goes in accordance with the prophetic aspect and vice versa. This is one and the same. Both of these have to be in harmony, right? And we live our life accordingly to this, right? So over the course of the years, this idea has been twisted that we, although we are not of this world, we are in this world. But I want to ask you this morning to please consider that the more you pray, the more you study God's word, the more you grow in your spirituality and your maturity with Jesus, may that relationship with God that is vertical may result in a horizontal relationship that leads you to share the things that you learn and the growth that you have experienced with others. Panama City Saints, look around you. Look around you. Everybody, look around you. Look the person right next to you. Look around you. Raise your hand if you know 100% of the people in this sanctuary. I cannot do that myself. Let me tell you a secret. Our church is growing.
Amen.
Tell to your neighbor, our church is growing. We spend thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and more thousands of dollars trying to reach someone that we don't know. And every single Sabbath, over the last year or so, the Lord brings people here to us.
Amen.
And we are willing to spend all of this money, but we are not able to spare a high, happy Sabbath. How are you with someone in our midst? It is our job. It is our responsibility that if the Lord is bringing the people to hear His truth, we are the ones to make them feel at home and welcomed.
Amen.
And even more than that, discipled.
Amen.
And love them. Right?
Amen.
Why don't we make this commitment for 2023? Amen?
Amen?
Let's get together. Let's know our stories. Let's be in one accord. Let's unite ourselves. The Lord is here. Amen?
Amen.
He is able. He is moving. And He is mighty. Glory be to God. So we find this idea that these two sections have to be kept in accordance with each other. The historical section or narrative section and also the prophetic section. But I want to share with you one last lesson from the book of Daniel with you. Let me tell you this. As you can see in this diagram, and with this I finish, you have the summary in Daniel chapter 1. Are you guys with me?
Yes.
The outline of the book. But then there's a connection. You have the two sections right here, the wisdom or narrative section and the prophecy section. But there's a connection between chapter 2 and chapter 7 that is undeniable. You have the statue with the four kingdoms, right? And you then have the four beasts in chapter 7. Are you guys with me? You can see this throughout the book. There's a connection between chapter 3 with the Hebrew boys going into the plain of Dura, right? And also you have chapter 6, Daniel in the lion's den. It's the same kind of trial and preparation and judgment and test that they have to endure. A group and now an individual, right? You have this idea in verses 4 and 5, in chapters 4 and 5. And if you go to the prophetic book, you'll find those connections as well. So I want you to understand that not only the Bible, not only Scripture, but our lives as Seventh-day Adventist Christians, they need to be placed in harmony. If you say that you are a believer of God, if you say that you are that you keep the Sabbath as holy, if you are communicating all of these things and you tell the world that you are so, that has to be reflected in the way that you do life. Amen. If there's a disconnect between what you say and who you are, what you say and what you do, there's a problem with who you are. So with that in mind, I share with you my last lesson. And that is that God is the God of history. Amen? Amen. God is the God of what? History. God is the God of history. So Panama City Saints, I do not know your goals for 2023. I do not know what you're going through. I do not know the desert or wilderness that you're going through like we said last week. But I do know that God continues to be seated on the throne. Amen. He is the one that holds not only the world, but also the future in His hand. Amen. He has demonstrated that in the book of Daniel, in the book of Revelation, throughout history. So what are you afraid of? God is with you.
Amen.
He is for you. He has committed to fight your battles. So let's go and walk into 2023 making the commitment that we want to get closer to Jesus, that we want to learn more about prophecy. But along with learning more about prophecy, we want to learn more about prayer.
Amen.
That we want to learn more about holiness that separates us from the world. But we also need to make the conscious commitment to take the challenge that as a result of such a holiness, we go and we bring others on board with us. And lastly, in the midst of our trials and tribulation, we understand that God, the God of history, continues to be in control. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Let's all stand together. Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we humbly come before your presence one last time, once more. We are grateful for the message that you have communicated to us this Sabbath morning. Lord, we want you to sanctify us. Help us to be more like you. And as we are transformed to the stature of Jesus Christ, may we open ourselves to the possibility of bringing others alongside us. I pray, Lord, that knowing that you, the God of history, continues to be in control, that we may find the assurance that is necessary for us to move forward. I pray for every single individual in this sanctuary and those watching online in the mighty name of Jesus. All God's people say,
Amen.
Amen.
The closing hymn is hymn number 618, stand up for Jesus. Hymn number 618, stand up for Jesus. Thank you.
Let's bow our heads as we have the benediction. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the message we've had today, for the fellowship, for your spirit being here, Lord. And we pray that as we go to our homes throughout the week, that you'll continue to fill us with your spirit. And may that spirit, that light, shine out so others can see Jesus in us. We ask all of these things in thy name. Amen.